Good evening, ladies and germs. Let's check. Yep, OBS is good. Isn't, don't know why it's not. That's weird. Why is it not? Twitch. You're supposed to be streaming. Yeah, you're online. What's YouTube? Yep, YouTube is working. For whatever reason, I'm not seeing. Yeah, just load in. This is going to be the link I'll provide today. Excellent. All right. What's this? Yeah, I don't know why this isn't working properly, and it's take too long to figure out why. So we're just gonna start. And if people come in and whatnot, because it's live on YouTube, so and they can still use the chat room. So that's what we're gonna do. All right, so. After some technical difficulties that we're going to ignore, let's get started. And thank you for joining us. This is the home stretch, a big game, number 5 Oregon. Oh, hey, finally that percolated. Maybe that will indicate that we're live on Twitch as well. So I'm going to check that. But number 5 Oregon versus number 1 Washington State, big game for the pack, for a chance at the national title, at least for Washington State, probably for Oregon, maybe if they won, they could do it as well. But Washington State is trying to close out down the stretch. Yeah. Okay. We are now properly live on Twitch as well. So that is helpful, because that's a lot easier for people to find usually. Anyway, let's take a quick look at Oregon. He is out. So Curtis is playing, but Curtis is a lot faster, with a lot more awareness. Does he run the ball? Not really, no. That's a very good halfback. 82 yards a game. Does he receive? 22 yards a game. 8 receiving touchdowns. Yeah, he does do it in the red zone. Probably that angle route. That's tough to cover. Yeah, well, it's not a great fullback, but that's not surprising. And some very good top 2 receivers, but after 3 and 4, they go downhill. Not a great tight end. He's out, but Butler isn't too far behind. But what that means is James is, if James is there all across the board backup, that makes it difficult. Yeah, they've got different guys at tackle and at guard, but they're both in the 70s if it gets to the third man in either of those situations. Impact right end. Good linebackers. First up, we have Washington State at number 1 Washington State at number 5 Oregon. What are you seeing? Ridiculous kicker.
Great secondary, great linebacking core.
All right. Yeah, great. Coach is saying great secondary and great linebacking core for Oregon. Not surprising. They play in the pack. It's packed, pass heavy conference. You need that quality in the secondary and quality in the linebackers. Tenth in rushing offense. That is surprising for the pack, but But yeah, and that, I mean, defensively, really good. And even, you know, top 30 against the rush, that's a good, good defense. That's an excellent rushing game. An insane rushing game. Against the number two rush defense, but I have to believe for Oregon that's got to be an option rush. I don't think they're going up the gut, especially not with a fullback that bad. But we've seen teams play fullbacks that bad and not care that they're lousy. That is a thing we have seen. I'm sorry. What position does Penn play on your team? Number 30. Okay. Interesting, he gets to... I ask because, you know, if I saw that name more often, I would be tempted to put House of Penn. Excuse me. This one's going to be down in the end zone for a touchback. Seniors are throwing out the home jerseys for the final time in their career. For these kids, an awfully emotional time. You always want to go out in style and get a win. The quarterback brings his troops out of the field for the first drive of the game.
Hit somebody was what the crowd roared when Buddy the Goon came over the boards. Coach. Outstanding job there by the linebacker to find his way through on the blitz.
Did that one not work?
From their own 18-yard line. Third down. Great effort by this kid to get in there and make the sack.
Not a great return there, but excellent field position on the early three and out. Big tackles for loss early.
Couldn't have asked for better field position than this. In the shotgun and five wide out.
We see a fantastic use of the middle slant there, running right through a great gap, and I believe intentionally falling to the ground at the end of that run there. And that is, of course,
Vincent Vega.
Vincenzo.
Vincent Vega, our man in Amsterdam.
About average for Pauly Shore on his run. Not a great rushing team, Washington State, but they'll do enough to make you respect it. So that's the second time Washington State's thrown to that receiver on that drag route. It's a great thing earlier in the game because it's an easy pass to make. You know, that'll get you 2 yards. And it, as we saw before, you know, it can get you great yards after the catch. As we watch Pauly Shore break one tackle and get 5 yards when he looked like he was only going to get one. It's rare to see Pauly Shore pull off that kind of move. Almost as rare as seeing a run on first down from Washington State. Again, that drag route to Huff, that's a moneymaker. Didn't get the touchdown, but it's inches.
I bet they're going to miss him as a target when he moves on. You get used to having such a reliable receiver on your side.
Became the mighty Battle Cat, and I became He-Man, the most powerful man in the universe. Only three others share this secret.
An excellent offensive performance from Washington State there. We'll see if the defense can do the same thing they did last time. Get into Oregon's backfield and mess them up.
Take away their ability to run.
it's second down. And down he goes at the 48.
Another good option from Oregon, but caught short. Very aggressive from Oregon there, but with the running game they've got, it's understandable why they would go for it. Jimmy Buffett, 2 tackles for loss this game. With a minute and a half left in the first quarter. That's an impressive performance from the Parrot Head. Third and long here for Oregon. I didn't want to mess you up by calling that when you were still returning it. Now that interception was definitely helped by the fact that it was there were two defenders on that receiver. One guy clearly had the receiver, and the other guy was able to go for the pick. That's not necessarily something that you're going to see if you don't have help. This is why, you know, calling a good defense that's appropriate to the down and distance is important, because it's always, always better to have multiple guys. Solid run there from Pauly Shore for the first down. He's not going to get you miles and miles, but, you know, he's getting a decent box office return. Yeah, also important because it does set up other options that are important to have later. Similarly, we see another pass to Huff on the drag route out of the middle slant from the 5 wide. That's doing a couple of things. It's making the left slot receiver and the right slot receiver, one who runs an out route, the other who runs a slant from right to left. It's going to make them more available when he calls that middle slant and actually needs 10 yards instead of 2 yards later in the game. It also helps set up his, you know, 8 to 17 yard passing play of the 4 verticals. So, you know, calling plays early to make sure other plays are available later, just like that run that we've seen Pauly Shore been doing. Another good run from Vincent Vega. Coach making the point that second and short is explicitly pretty much for setting things up for later, because you have the luxury of a down that you don't really need to absolutely positively do anything with. If you get to third and three is entirely manageable. As we see Coach get to another second and three to give himself even more flexibility. That combination of routes with the tight end and the fullback coming around is great, and is really good if you can tell that there are linebackers blitzing, because it just means that there aren't going to be enough live bodies in the middle of the field. If you can get off that pass, it can be risky, because you really need to wait until the fullback's made his cut. Otherwise, you hit him in the back of the head. An impressive play there from both Vega and Voorhees. Vega throws on the run because he knows that if he stops, he's going to get hit. That Oregon defender's just too close. But floated it nice and gently. Voorhees made the adjustment to come back for it, and then had excellent yards after with that spin move. As we see Washington State in the red zone for the second time. An interesting play there from Washington State. Decided that they didn't like most of what they saw, so they went for the safe checkdown. Always, you know, good safe play, rather than you didn't need to throw it somewhere riskier. And, you know, maybe means other things are going to be open later on as they put more men in the box to start fighting that drag route against all of his shotgun sets. Excellent defensive call from Oregon. Washington State making the smart move, getting it away. And there we see that's exactly the play that Washington State was setting up with those Pauly Shore ISOs. We get a play-action pass that just is to the tight end with nobody around him.
Fight, fight, fight for Washington State. Win the victory. Win the day for crimson and gray. Best in the West, we know you'll all do your best. So on, fight till the end. Honor and glory you must win. So fight for Washington State and victory.
As we now hear the Washington State fight song in a round between the Washington State Marching Band and Tom Tuttle of Tacoma, Washington. So far, Washington State doing an excellent job moving the ball fairly easily on offense and keeping Oregon out of the end zone. They've had some good option runs, but just as many have been stopped in the backfield, although this looks like a big one. A couple of touchdown saving hits there at the end. Bonner is going to be hot, at least for the rest of this half, if not the whole game, off of a run like that and the runs he's been getting. Oregon State, not out of this game yet, clearly. That running back is hot, and he is dragging the rest of this team with him. If anyone does see what the score of the Maryland game is over the course of this, please do let me know in chat, because that's very important to me, and I'm not necessarily paying attention to the ticker at the bottom of the screen when I'm trying to announce or play. And that has a big effect on who's in the lead in the Big Ten East. Ooh, Iowa lost. That's not conference. As Vincent Vega throws off target, probably for the first time this afternoon. Vincent Vega probably running about 25 yards there in order to get 10 in forward motion. See that he is now tired. Washington State's going to have to be a little bit careful with Vincent Vega. The upside, of course, is that they have plenty of time on the clock right now. An incredible fumble there from Vincent Vega, right into the hands of the Duck defender. The Duck quarterback breaks the pocket, but is only really able to get back to the line of scrimmage, getting to 3rd and 8 for giving Washington State a chance to stop him and get their own 2-minute drill. Complete, and he's shut down at the 23. Oregon completing the pass despite being hit at the time. Looked like the Washington State defender there, preventing his teammate from making the pick. See how Vig responds. This is now opportunity for Washington State to stretch the lead beyond 4 points before the half. They have plenty of time on the clock. And three timeouts. As Huff takes it out of the deep end zone, only gets back to about the 18-19 yard line. Vega, nice and well rested now. Washington State spending a lot of Vega's energy and a fair amount of clock on that, but it really was the only thing that was there. Alan Rickman making the reception as the clock ticks to 1:01. Very patient read there from Washington State on the stick, the empty stick, I should say. A very patient read there again on the stick. You could see that that the tight end was actually open very, very early, but that's a 5 or 6 yard pass unless he breaks the first tackle, and it definitely doesn't stop the clock, which not what Washington State's interested in right now. Sacrifice to the early pass to roll out and make sure that he's going to get a pass from one of his receivers who's going to be able to get out of bounds. Another an angle route for sure. This time from the other side. It's when they don't have the right coverage, it's a very reliable 6 yard pass. However, it does cost Washington State that timeout. Washington State is up 4.
push him out at the 15.
What? Yeah, great play by Vega in order to get the dump off pass to Eric Estrada before he goes down. There was a moment where the normal tight end was wide open, but just unable to make that pass, made the smart play, dumping it off to Estrada in the flat.
First and 10, ball on the 15. They'll line up with five wide receivers. He's going to try and scramble. Under pressure, slides down to the ground.
The offense coordinator right now is very happy with the execution. That's the fifth first down in this drive alone.
A big scramble there from Vega. He did have the drag route, but that wouldn't have got 10 yards like the scramble did. Making sure to get everybody a little bit of rest there, including waiting at the line of scrimmage before that play, spending about 10 seconds to rest Vega. Washington State moving it back to a two-possession lead, thanks to the efficient passing and making sure that Oregon only got 3 points, not seven, on that last drive. And Oregon's probably going to have one, maybe two chances to do something here before halftime. An excellent, again, tackle for loss. That seems to be the way things are going today, is either that Bonner is getting stopped behind the line of scrimmage, or he's making first down on those options. It's really one or the other. Once again, Washington State attempts another return from deep in the end zone, gets short of the 20-yard line.
Well, the guys are chomping at the bit down there, waiting for the game to start back up. So they pick up quite a few yards on that play, Kirk.
Well, that was an excellent route, and he did a great job of holding on to the football.
Number three comes in at quarterback. We've got a first and 10. Ball on their own 31. Gets to about the 34-yard line. Second down and 7. Ball on their own 34. And he's stopped behind the line. Loss of 1 yard on the play. That'll bring up 38. Wide. Scrambling around. Rolls right. He's taken down at the 42.
What? Perfect timing on the cut there. A few more steps, that's going to be short of the first down by quite a few yards. That drag route is all about knowing when to make that cut. Vega still a bit winded. We see John McClain coming in to give Vig a little break. With an excellent run to the weak side by Paulie Shore. And Vega, now hale and healthy, in a wonderful shade of green. Ernst Blofeld on the timing route there hit pretty much perfectly right as he set his feet from turning around. Paulie Shore with the 9 yards on the option handoff, running around his blockers who got chopped up in the middle of the field there. Vega, once again, with the scramble and a slide this time, but he's again pretty tired.
could potentially turn this football game around. They're down by a couple scores, but if you're the offense and you're on the sideline and you're not,
and it looked like it was open, like he wasn't on that guy, and then he changed his mind. Oregon's staying in this game. That pick's going to give him a lot of momentum, but Washington State's defense has been doing a very good job against this option. Excellent pass rush there from Washington State. Very clearly not a passing team, at least not with this quarterback. And only really passing when they absolutely have to, and that's giving Washington State the ability to predict the run and do something about this option run. Yeah, Washington State calling a timeout there in order to get the right formation, the right personnel out on the field for a 3rd and 11. That momentum from the pick is getting Oregon some distance here. Good afternoon, CWAC. Another tackle for loss there, as we've said, you know. When they're hitting that tackle for a loss, it's doing quite nicely, but when it misses, it misses. Excellent user tackle there to put that receiver in the dirt because he had no help coming anytime soon. Washington State's defense doing a fantastic job to force the punt on the possession after the pick, but an excellent punt there from Oregon to put them on their own 1 yard line. As we see Pauly Shore get 5 yards to get a bit of safety, safe distance away from that end zone line for Vincent Vega, because we know he likes to hold on to the ball and run around.
Second and five. Ball on their own five.
gets him up in field. He's to the 20. That's a great tackle at the 23-yard line.
Vincent Vega with a fantastic option keeper. What?
And he's tackled at the 47-yard line. They go with a run, and that'll be a gain of 9. That makes it 2nd and 2. Wants to throw outside. Makes the grab and steps out right away.
This time, Vega waits a little bit longer, makes sure that the tight end there is wide open for the lob ball over to the end zone, the edge line.
It's 1st and 10. Ball on the 29. He makes it out maybe to the 26-yard line. A little longer on the field, and we'll find out whose it is.
Yeah, and you don't even have, well, it's not even that. It's also, like, you know, you don't have, holding set to aggressive.
Quarterback all by himself in the backfield with 5 wideouts. Short pass.
That drag route to Huff, it has been there all day.
You know what? After a play like that, I wouldn't be the least bit surprised if they went to the air again.
Well.
From the 26-yard line, 2nd down.
Another short over the middle to Huff for yards after.
The quarterback seeing the whole field and finding the guy who had the best chance of making a catch.
play of this drive. Could they get another interception here? That's what they got last time this offense was in the red zone. He's under pressure.
You know, at that point, I think grabbing quarterbacks are just better off just taking a sack. You have to be very careful as you're feeling pressure to throw the ball just to throw the ball. If you feel like you're not going to be able to make the play and the defense got you, just give up on that play and get ready for the next down.
Ooh, and a lucky reception there.
By the power of Grayskull, I am the power! Cringer became the mighty Battle Cat, and I became He-Man, the most powerful man in the universe. Only three others share this secret.
East Davis update. The Cougars looks like they're ready for the kick.
McCullough needs to return.
Excellent kick. And it goes into the end zone, down for a touchback. Washington State's defense, they've got the it factor.
The it factor, the swagger, whatever you want to call it, when they take the field, they know they're better than you. And it's a group of 11, they play like they know they're going to stop you.
We're about set to start things up again.
Now we see Oregon coming out. They're 18 points behind Washington State. This means they're going to be operating out of a different playbook. Clearly not getting rid of that option, but it's going to be a different kind of playbook in general. Probably see more passing than we have the rest of the game.
From their own 21-yard line, second down. Goes quick to the receiver, falls incomplete. He tried to hit his receiver in stride, but overthrew it a little too much.
That'll come in time. Just repetition, throwing that same pass over and over, and he'll be fine.
Inside their 35. Yeah, this is a very aggressive move from Oregon. Under 4 minutes, their own 35-yard line, but it's only 1 yard. And that looked like it was probably actually the same passing play as the play before.
Less than 3 minutes in the game. First down grab by the receiver. He's taken down at the 13.
That makes it first and 10. Washington State on the 13-yard line. 2 minutes and 37 seconds left in the game. Already up 18 points. Pauly Shore with a 9-yard rush. Clearly Oregon not expecting the run out of that formation there. As we see John McClain again. McClain hands off to Shore. Shore gets it probably to the 2-yard line. 1-yard line, I'm sorry. With a minute 45 here, Spectre has all of the options for Washington State. Both teams' goal line, crowding that line of scrimmage.
Fight, fight, fight for Washington State. Win the victory. Win the day for crimson and gray. Best in the West, we know you'll all do your best. So on, fight till the end. Honor and glory you must win. So fight for Washington State and victory.
And now Washington State up by 25 points with a minute 19 left. That clock and that lead giving Oregon the jitters.
So the penalty will make it first and 15.
Hit as he throwed and hit as he caught it. Prevents yards after.
That,
my friends, right there was a unicorn getting a sack on a screen pass. It looked like the defensive coverage of the screen receiver was such that he just hesitated and didn't throw the ball. And that's the only reason why this, you know, that's not something you should try and do. It never works on purpose. Yep. Huff with an excellent return. As we can see, you know, a fantastic amount of yardage for Vega. Vega, the Heisman leader right now. We said it before, we'll say it again. at Washington State, if Vincent Vega doesn't do it, it does not get done. Coach Spectre there seeing that the route on the four verticals was open in the quick window rather than waiting for it. Once again, Huff on that drag route. That's been one of the major contributors for his 136 yards today. Leonard Bernstein with the reception there. I think he picked that one off. I'm not sure he was the receiver. Oh, the coach is saying he was the receiver. Well, it looked like the guy behind him was going to be the guy. When we look at that play selection, 25 runs, 34 passes for Washington State. That's fairly even for them. Another screen, but this time you could see that the defense read it well, got four defenders over into the flat where the screen was happening and just gobbled that screen up. Team tackling, make sure that it gets to third and very long again. All right, once again, an excellent performance by Washington State. 42-10 over Oregon. That defense winning that game, getting into the backfield, and really preventing that option from working often enough. It definitely worked some of the time and productively when it did, but it did not work often enough. All right, let's try that again. There we go. As we see, with the Leonard Bernstein, the last touchdown there. Leaping touchdown. So that's interesting. Coach is telling me that he had a strong safety in a linebacker position this game in order to use him to blitz the quarterback with some frequency. It was, you should say, quite productive. Now, was this your first strong safety or second strong safety that you used first? Okay, so they had to take a corner and play him at strong safety, which you could only do because they were seniors with high awareness. It's not something you can do all the time or with much regularity, but it's something that can be productive. Vega, 29 completions for 314 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception, and 100 yards rushing. Nine different receivers, but Huff with the bulk of it. By far, by more than twice what the next guy. 3 sacks from TJ King. Yeah, and just a whole lot of tackles for loss in general this game. That was really the key to stopping their offense, was that you knew that you seemed to know that they were going to be going to the option on first down very reliably, and were able to get tackles for loss on that first down option often enough to force them to punt. Yeah.
We felt like we could gamble against them beating us in the air.
Yeah. No. Yeah. That was fair. You totally made the right call, saying, hey, you give it to them through the air, but we're going to spend all this time stopping the run, and it definitely worked out for you.
Because he busted the big one that set him up for the touchdown.
Yep.
And then the turnover, based probably off of the offensive momentum, and then the field goal. I thought the defense did well to stop him to a field goal.
Oh yes, the defense did very well to stop him to a field goal after that. After that.
And then Vega responded with a good 2-minute drill.
Yes, he did.
And then the rest of the game was just playing against the run and doing what we need to do.
Yeah. All right. So let's get this saved in the books. We'll swap a hard drive out. Some stats first, though.
2-9 on third down.
Yeah, versus 5-5 on third down by Washington State.
Yeah. The defense was so good that we were able to overcome that.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, they 25 rushes for 73 yards. That's, you know, when they were making, you know, they were, what, 211 was their average?
Well, we had 26 first downs. We had more first downs than they had rushing attempts.
Yeah, that is true.
That'll keep them off the field.
That will keep them off the field.
Short passes.
Yeah, definitely giving it to Shore more often than usual, but no, when you knew that, hey, planning around making 2 or 3 yards on that Shore ISO, and with the weapons you have at receiver, not really worried about it.
You know, I mean, Vega had a fumble, but he also had 103, and then he had a pick, but he also had 303. It's like, even when he has a bad game, he has a good game.
Yeah, he probably should still be in the lead for that Heisman after this, despite those 2 turnovers.
I'll take 2 turnovers if you're going to give me 6 touchdowns.
Yeah, that's perfectly reasonable. All right, so we're going to get this saved and then go down for just a second as we swap hard drives for number 20, Penn State, at number 14, Ohio State.
We take sole position lead in Pac-12 North. We got 2 rivalry games left before the Pac-12 championship that we will hopefully qualify for.
Ooh, number 3 undefeated Cincinnati losing to number 10 UCF.
Also undefeated.
Who is also undefeated. That is interesting. Okay. UMass winning their yearly game. UAB beating USC.
Holy shit.
That, yeah, USC is getting fired.
Could be.
Oh, man. That is not good.
That's one of those do not pass go, do not. Yeah, that's just, I'm there.
Oh, yes. Yes, it did. Yes.
Marshall's third win. If I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
Another overtime win by Vandy.
Yeah.
A close run thing, but
Indeed. And now for Ohio State.
It's in the game. Let's see, let's take a quick look. Do we have... Ooh, looks like West is injured for Ohio State. Time to scout them. Edwards, 32 yards a game, so he's definitely rushing a bit, but not a tremendous amount with only a 3.5 yard average. Now, he's also a 19. This is an impact player. Interesting. Is he... I think Edwards was hurt for a while. Interesting. But now he's back. But the other guy is the impact player. Interesting. All right. West is their starter at 94. 78 yards is a game and 20 through the air. He's injured. But Yates is an impact player, which is to say that West has been out for a while. Yeah, and he's doing an excellent job as well. All right. But what it means is if they go to a two halfback system, they're bringing in Daniels, and that's fine. No real fullback to speak of. Wide receivers, not a whole lot of depth. Going to tight ends very early in the depth chart of their wide receivers there. But two solid, if not incredible, receivers. But a very, very good senior tight end at 91. And, I mean, 81 is the lowest they've got on their offensive line with that center. But he's got a 90 right guard right next to him to give him some help. Hey, Jameen. We're just getting started for the second game of our doubleheader, doing a little scouting on Ohio State. Seeing what it is they've got, and the answer is they have everything. 93 right end there, who's an impact player. I missed the left end. 90, so great ends. And they do not have depth at tackle. Their third D tackle is an end. So that's a really good defensive tackle, but after that, not a lot of depth. Excellent at linebacker. And their left outside was an 89. 89, 92, 89 impact. And then cornerback, that's where they've got some defensive depth at, despite the fact that it's a strong safety as the fifth corner. 92, yeah, and so, you know, great secondary. And that kicker and that punter, I mean, that punter's got no power, but that kicker's quite good. All right. So now I'm going to turn the headset over to Coach Spectre for our play-by-play and get started.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you enjoyed the first game of our doubleheader. We're number one, knocked off number five. Now we move to the Big Ten, where matters have yet to be decided in the Big Ten East, as the number 20 Penn State Nittany Lions make a visit to Columbus, Ohio, to the Horseshoe, to take on the number 14 ranked Ohio State Buckeyes. Ohio State fifth on the ground, while Penn State's first against the ground. We'll see if Penn State can rack up the first downs needed to keep the Buckeyes off the field. Derrick Henry, the tight end prospect, along with Corey Burke, a five-star tight end prospect, visiting Ohio State. They expect to throw to the tight end maybe today.
Well, also, I'm going after Derrick Henry.
We've got another snow game in the upper Midwest. The Great Lakes region strikes again. A whiteout by the visiting Nittany Lions, wearing the all-white uniforms with blue numbers. Will they be hard for the offense to see, or for the defense, or both? The computer, the user? That remains to be seen. It's going to be an interesting ball game. You see, it's Maryland, Ohio State, Michigan, and Penn State all tied with one loss in the conference. A closely fought battle in the Big Ten East. An important part of that will be decided today. It's an El Nino winter here in the upper Midwest. The second snow game of the weekend involving a user.
This one's going to be down in the end zone for a touchback. Well, from that first time they walked on campus as a recruit to their freshman season, and now here they are as seniors.
Senior day here in Columbus. The final home game for several members of the Buckeyes, taking on their fierce rival, the Nittany Lions of Penn State, led by Coach Ninja here in League One. The run up the gut gets one positive yard. First play of the game. Like a couple of prize fighters feeling each other out. Back to pass, fumbles the ball, picked up by the defense. We're going to want to see the instant replay here to see exactly what happened and when. That looks like a clean fumble. Ohio State will take over here. Perhaps a little bit of icy hands affecting possession there. Some slightly camouflaged Nittany Lions jump out of the shadows and tackle the running back there for no gain. Finding some time, Penn State unable to get a second pass rusher into the quarterback before he could get the ball away. Now Ohio State facing 1st and 10 in the red zone. Breaks the tackle down to the 3. And Penn State's going to have to sell out here with their backs against the wall. They do sell out. They guess correctly. One more of those, and they may have something to work with. It's good, but it's not quite good enough. Ohio State gets the first down. Now has several chances here. Penn State is going to do everything they can. They are not giving up the fight. But you can only do so much for so long. Ohio State's no huddle, possibly wearing down a couple of players on the front seven of the Nittany Lions, running several plays consecutively there right at the end of that drive. But Ohio State didn't get it easily. Penn State put up a fight, but the momentum off of the turnover, perhaps just a little bit too much to overcome. First blood goes to the Buckeyes as Penn State looks to respond. Early days here in the ball game as the opening minutes. 5 minutes left in the first quarter. Just getting started here in Columbus. Quarterback for Penn State, Sledge, coming up big with an accurate throw there for big yardage. It's the fullback out of the backfield. Nifty little passing play on first down by Penn State there. Nick Scott's third carry of the game. Early days here, but you'll expect that throughout the afternoon he will be an important part of the Penn State offense as they find their footing here with another first down crossing the middle of the field. Tough sledding in the snow there. Wide receiver against the grain. Gets another yard and a half after the catch, a 6-yard gain, setting up third and short. as the Nittany Lions move left to right across your radio dial. Great rush there by Penn State's Nick Scott. So after several short gains, netting a few building first downs, Penn State lulls the opposition to sleep before striking quickly with a long pass play. That's going to equalize the scoreline as Ohio State will look to build upon their previous momentum garnered by their defense. In close games like this, every possession is likely to matter. And he tackles him hard at the 36. A broken tackle nets an extra 8 yards on a first down for the Buckeye running game. Penn State looks to rebound here on first and 10. Two-yard gain by Yates. Tight end splitting out wide, unable to break the tackle. The quarterback had to throw off of his back foot. You got to believe that affected the timing of that play. Otherwise, you'd expect the tight end to be able to break the tackle out in the open field and get a few extra yards. However, now third down, Penn State making the stop. So a couple of short plays have a large impact on the possession of the football. Just like that, Penn State with the football once again, following the quick three and out. I think Penn State at this moment perfectly content to play things by the book, take yards where they can get them. You see right there with the nice, safe outlet pass. Not very much risk on that play. You'd imagine that Penn State would look to keep them honest and salt away some of this clock with some first downs here on this drive.
Here we go.
Easier said than done against a highly competitive Ohio State team. A contender, as we said before, the broadcast for the Big Ten Eastern Division crown. Makes the first down catch. Cole Robinson, a player of note for the Nittany Lions, making what must be his 100th third down conversion. Penn State comes out with a fresh quarter. Fresh set of downs and possession. Bullock in motion right to left across your radio dial. And then a run up the gut by Scott nets them the ideal second and one. Time to play. Time to have a little flexibility. Time to put second and one to use. See Penn State, short pass over the middle. Could lead to a subsequent deep pass out of the same look. Scott wrangled in the backfield by the Ohio State defense. He's got 25 yards so far, but it's early yet in the second quarter. Bottled up that time, but he's had some effective runs today. Great keeper there. Sledge gets him to third and short. And they'll have a perfectly legitimate chance here. They're going to catch him off guard here with a no huddle. Able to get the first down.
Pulling a shiny black steel jackhammer, been chipping up rocks for the great highway. If I take my time, balling that jack and drinking my wine.
Passing play gets 4 key yards. It'll be third and two here on the next play from the 6-yard line. Penn State will get it on the ground. That gets them to first and goal. They go with the no huddle. Keeping that tired defense on the field. Touchdown, Penn State.
One quarter down. I really haven't seen too much separation between these two squads. Might be neck and neck the whole way. He fights forward to about the 29.
See some no huddle there by Ohio State. A big play down the left sideline. 34-yard gain. We'll set them up with the first down in Penn State territory. Ohio State with a triple option up the gut. Getting 6 yards on first down. See a third and long here, third and 11. Penn State giving their defense the full rest here as they come out in the dime normal. And a cover two man here on third and long. Ohio State looking to keep the score close before the half. Runs the screen pass. A huge monster block down the field. Opens up the first down play again on the left sideline on third down. Ohio State stays with the no huddle. Multiple tacklers bringing Yates down after a 2 yard gain. Running the draw play, Yates stumbles and bumbles down to a third and one. Penn State back to their cover two man. We've got a false start. That'll give Penn State a chance to get a quick rest. Maybe get a couple of different personnel on the field if they so choose. We'll have third and long coming up next. Breaks the tackle and another one, and that is 6 points for the Buckeyes. Screen pass to the right side. We see a couple of perimeter plays there by the Buckeyes. Three plays there inside the 40-yard line. A couple of sideline screens to the left, and then one getting the halfback out into the open field. Ohio State letting their skill position players, letting their impact players make the big plays here on offense. We got a tie ball game as Penn State looks to take a 2 minute drill down the field with a full slate of timeouts in a tie ball game. Under immense pressure there. No chance really to get a good throw off as you saw the jailbreak at the line of scrimmage. That's what you get when the sliders are set with zero pass blocking. Second and 10, that's good yardage. 8.5, 9 yards by Darryl Douglas. Double D gets him to third and one. Sledge for a loss of 3 as Ohio State reads the read option perfectly, stuffing the drive on Penn State's half of the field. Their own 31-yard line, you figure there's not much option here other than to punt the ball back and let your defense do what your defense is good at. You have the advantage that the opponent has to be predictable. There's a minute and 24 seconds left. And while to a user that may seem like a fair amount of time, especially with 2 timeouts, the computer is going to treat it as if there's 40 or 50 seconds left the whole way down the field. A little delayed action there. Somebody's going to break open at some point. You have that much time. Penn State's going to need to get to the quarterback a little sooner than they did on that previous play. This time the screen pass gets stuffed. We'll see what happens here. Ohio State could take some valuable seconds off the clock facing second down. Tackled inbounds. That clock will be moving. There they go. They called the timeout at the 1 minute mark. So they lost 5 seconds or so. But they did get it off pretty quickly. Won't cost them too much. Now we face second and 11. 1 minute exactly remaining in the first half. All day to throw. Same situation as the play before. You give the quarterback that much time and somebody's going to break open. No telling if it was the second, third, or fourth receiver. It was not the primary look on either of the last two plays. They get the stop. As a famous old coach said, they ain't in yet. Second and goal on the 1. Only 1 timeout remaining for the Buckeyes. We'll see here if they can guess correctly. Ohio State going to keep everybody on the field. Penn State without much choice but to sell out again. Ohio State gets the 6. 27 seconds before the half. Penn State will have an opportunity. But that opportunity had better be covered in bacon grease because it's going to have to slip through a tiny crack.
Closely all day long and for Wisconsin they're looking to win it. 24 seconds.
You figure there's certain passes that only take 3 seconds. I mean, if you can get a player out of bounds, you can stop the clock as well. You've got to get about maybe 60 yards for a good field goal attempt. You've got 3 timeouts. We'll see what they come up with. They get the first. They will smartly call the timeout. They did get the first down, but At that point, with 18 seconds left, you're running out of opportunities to call timeout. You hope to get out of bounds here, but if you can't, then you'll take a spike or a timeout. They get the first. They spend the timeout. 14 seconds left. Now if they can get a pass beyond 10 yards and spike the ball, they'll have some options here. That play took almost no time off the clock. They're pretty much in the same scenario they were in previously. We'll see if they try a different shotgun five wide look. They're going to run with the wide trips. Looking to get 10 yards and a spike. Well, now you have total freedom because you can spend your time out after this play. You're figuring on getting 10 yards. And spiking or calling timeout. They get the yardage. They call the timeout. They are going to get the kicking unit out of the field from the 27-yard line. See if Penn State can steal three here. No shades of Vinatieri here before the half and the blizzard. But Penn State down by 7 in a battle here with the Buckeyes of Ohio State, but fighting tooth and nail. A closely fought first half. It could have gone either way. One play here, one play there. You get the sense that this game is going to come down to the final possession or two.
Is up a score.
Breaks another couple of tackles. The option run out to the outside. Effective there. We're seeing a little bit of a replay here. It looks like the offense for Ohio State very similar to Oregon's offense that we saw in the first game of the doubleheader with a spread offense that would like to get the halfback the lion's share of the glory. We've got a 3rd and 3 coming here. Yards and a cloud of dust there on first down. 2nd and 7 here for the Nittany Lions. 5 minutes and 40 seconds remaining in the third quarter of a closely fought ball game. We see the double tight end routes. Christian Bullock, the backup tight end for Penn State, his third catch of the day. He's a guy that can sneak up on you. He may not be involved on every play, but he gets a couple of catches every game.
It's third down, and this offense is about 3 feet away from that first down marker. These fans are showing you why teams hate to come here, folks.
Wide receiver wide open on the third and short from their own 44-yard line. Penn State looks to begin anew. Penn State going no huddle once again. Gets Bullock with another pass. And now we'll give their offense a breather. You see a couple of guards there turning yellow. First and 10, though, for Penn State on Ohio State's 43-yard line. What they have done may have gotten a couple of guys tired, but it's been well worth it as they've matriculated the ball down this field.
From the 43-yard line. From the 43-yard line. First down.
Two-yard gain, keeping them honest on the ground, making that something they've got to think about. Nice quick hitting pass there to Cole Robinson, just what the doctor ordered for Penn State. Good play call, good execution there on second and long. See, once again, Penn State taking some time off of that clock to give some players some much-needed rest, facing third down here. Gets the first. Anthony Scott, a 10-yard catch. That's his sixth of the day for 75 yards. He has been the leading receiver for the Nittany Lions on the day. We see once again 15 to 20 seconds melted off of the play clock.
We've got a first and 10, ball on the 25-yard line.
Coverage was there that time. Ohio State, you see, starting to adjust slightly to some of the things that Penn State's trying to do. They've gotten a lot of yardage for the Nittany Lions to this point. And now you look to see what they're going to use those tools to set up.
From the 25-yard line.
second down.
They stayed home on the quarterback. They give it to Nick Scott. He gets a healthy 6 yard gain. It'll be 3rd and 4 for the Nittany Lions here. See the single safety high. And correctly, Penn State goes with the middle slant. When you see a 3-3-5 or a 4-2-5, and you see that single free safety high up in the middle of the field, rather than two safeties, you know that certain plays are going to have a higher percentage compared to other plays. Excellent throw to what I guarantee you, folks, was not the primary receiver on that play. A good adjustment there by Sledge in the pocket. Stayed calm amongst the pressure and fired the ball into the open man. Nick Scott with a carry up the gut, tying the ball game at 21 as we approach the end of the third quarter here. Yates with an effective first down conversion. You'll start to see him become less and less of a part of the game plan if Penn State can get the lead. As of now, though, he's still very much a part of the focus, especially here in the snow. As Ohio State gets the ball out to midfield, they are just across the stripe on the 49-yard line of Penn State. The no huddle will get them another first down. Some big plays there by the Penn State defense, setting them up with 3rd and a mile, 3rd and 16 here in the fourth quarter. Incompletion there, but you expect that Ohio State will be in field goal range from the 30-yard line. But the Penn State defense stiffening there early here in the fourth.
He gets it up, and it's long enough. No good. He missed it to the left. They missed the opportunity to take the lead.
So the two teams have traded missed field goals at this point. And now with 6 minutes and 30 seconds, a tie ball game presents Penn State with different opportunities than a deficit does.
You've got to be aware that capitalizing on this drive is crucial. You want to take the pressure off you and put it on your opponent. And he's taken down at the 29-yard line.
Scott stuffed up the gut. Penn State's defense rearing its head on first down.
Second down and 11 yards to the sticks. Ball on the 29-yard line.
The Ohio State defense coming out of your second 11. Penn State responds with the drag route and a first down. There were enough bodies there protecting him on the run after the catch that he was able to get a couple of blocks downfield. As more seconds melt away. Christian Bullock, the 2-yard gain, his 6th catch of the day. You see Sledge's numbers there, 22 out of 27 for 218 and a touch. He's also had a few effective runs. The open man, that's positive yardage. That was about the best result out of that play, looking at the receivers that were running routes.
I don't know if they'll be able to hear his cadence in the midst of all this mayhem.
See here at 3rd and 2, Penn State going back to the read option. He's got the first. That's all he needs. And the Nittany Lions live to fight another day. There to the Ohio State 46-yard line, 4:20 and counting.
From the 46-yard line, first down.
There is a hushed crowd and a sense of nervousness here in Columbus, Ohio, as Penn State melts time off the clock in a tie ball game, approaching field goal range. If they can get away with a little bit more conservatism, it's possible they could win this without Ohio State getting the ball back. Penn State's offensive line digging out 4 yards for Scott.
We're at play number 9 of this current drive. Just under 3 to go in regulation.
That'll get him to 3rd and 4. 2:15 remaining in the ball game. You could make the case that Penn State might be in field goal range, but given the weather today, given the fact that both kickers have missed field goals, I'm sure they'd like a little bit more comfort than where they are now. Gets the first down, a clutch play into the red zone of Ohio State. Penn State now on the 19-yard line. No real reason to take any risks whatsoever at this point. In a tie ball game, you wonder at what point Ohio State begins to use their timeouts. They may not use them the same way you or I might use them. All things considered, Penn State will take the result of that play as the clock continues to run as predicted in a tie ball game situation. Ohio State not convinced that this is an easy field goal. They will forego calling the timeouts. Penn State's welcome to see that. They run the pass. It's complete for negligible yards. That clock continues to move. And you'd think that if Penn State brings their unit on the field, they may be able to kick this with no time on the clock. Yeah, Ohio State's not going to call the timeout. They line this up properly, and they get a good kickoff with 2 or 3 seconds remaining. This game is over. He gets it as time expires. Penn State victorious. We'll take that for the winning field goal. Penn State victorious against the number 14 Ohio State Buckeyes on their turf, on their field, in the snow. Penn State now at 5-1 in the division. Ohio State drops to 4-2. At this point, Maryland and Michigan remain at 5-1 in the Big Ten East. We await those scores and more as we finish out the week in League One. We thank you for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. You can look forward to more League One action next weekend as Penn State continues to climb up the rankings, as Washington State continues to try for a national championship. We will have many exciting games down the stretch. We see there where Maryland gets the win with a 17-point fourth quarter. They will maintain their momentum as they close out their conference schedule. More information on the way, more suspense on the way, and more League One action on the way. Next weekend, look for updates on this channel throughout the course of this week as to when Washington State and Penn State will take the field once more. We thank you for joining us and see you next week.